Students, very good evening to all of you. Today we are going to learn about the types of conveyors. So in these types of conveyors, the six types of a conveyors we are going to learn its different components of the and its capacity, how it is operating, and what are all the principles involved in the conveyance, right? So the belt conveyor, bucket conveyor, screw conveyor, pneumatic conveyor, chain conveyor, and the roller conveyors. So these are all the some of the conveying material handling equipments used for conveying of the material from one place to other place. Okay, so so we'll see what is the conveying, material conveying or material handling. It is the function of the moving the right material to the right place, right time, in the right amount, in sequence and the right condition to minimize the production cost. What is the material handling? It is the rightness of the material to the right place and right time and right amount and in sequence. It's a very important thing, in sequence and in right condition to minimize the production cost, right? So that is about the material handling definition. So material handling equipments includes the number of operations that can be executed either by hand, by manual, or by mechanical means or devices to convey the material and to reduce the human drudgery. Okay, as we have said, that is a material, that is a production cost can be reduced, right? So these are all the few of the six types of conveyors we are going to see today. So first and foremost thing, the belt conveyor. A belt conveyor is a an endless belt operating between the two pulleys and its load is supported on the idlers. Okay, so there used to be a pulleys. It is a endless conveyor having the belt, and this belt is supported by the idlers. Okay, so that is the belt conveyor, right? So generally for cranes conveyance, the belt speed should not be exceeded, or it is a recommended that 2.5 to 2.8 meters per second, right? So we'll see the what is the capacity of the belt conveyor. The capacity of the belt conveyor, it's a meter cube per hour. Area of the cross section, that is a length into the width, that is the area of the cross section of the belt into belt speed, because it's a minutes by minutes, so we are multiplying with the 60 to convert it into the hour, right? So so here we can see the this is the two endless pulleys in which the belt is running, and the in between the equal distances we can see the idlers which supports to carry the material from one place to other place, which can reduce the production cost. Okay, this is the operation of the belt conveyor. And here you can see the how exactly this animation, where you can see the material is fed from the chute from one place to other place, and it is carrying with the belt. So in the both of the things we are having in a idler driven, this is a driven pulley and this is a driving pulley. So one is a operating, another one is a non-operating type of a pulleys are incorporated here, right? So belt idlers, the very important role of the idlers is to suitable for the different types of a materials with respect to the different angles. So that is the purpose of the putting the belt conveyor idlers here. The flat belt idlers are used to for granular material, the angle of repose not less than 35. Okay, and the troughing idlers with a 20 degree trough is used for conveying the all kind of a bulk material. The 20 degrees of trough for flat belts, especially flat belts are used for the angle of repose which is less than 35 degrees, right? So then you can see that the trough, that is a the angle between the 35 to 45, which is used for mainly small grain, small particles which are lighter in weight, in order to avoid the spillage. Here the angle of the repose or the idler's angle, you can see the idler's angle from here to here. This is the idler's angle. These are all the idlers 1 and 2. Okay, the horizontal axis to the inclined axis of the idler, which is termed to be in a the angle, right? So for lighter materials, the angle will be, the troughing angle of the idlers will be more. The idler spacing is equal to the width of the belt, and the spacing should not be exceeded more than the 1.2 meter. Say for example, this one idler, another idler. So in between the idler distance, it should not be more than 1.2 meter, or else the equal to the width of the belt, right? What is the belt tension? The tension developed at the driven pulley is transmitted the required power to move the loaded belt is known as the effective tension. The tension, so in between the two endless pulleys, the belt is moving. So whatever the tension is developed at the drive pulley will be transmitted to the driven pulley in order to transfer the power, right? So the effective tension in terms of T, it is a power kilowatts divided by belt speed. Okay, this gives you the effectiveness of the belt, right? So what are the applications of the belt conveyor? To convey the grains, food grains, and to convey the bulk grains, right? And mainly the along the horizontal axis of the conveyance is mostly preferred, this belt conveyor. In certain cases, the inclined paths also incorporated to convey the materials, right? The lighter materials can also be conveyed in production line, lighter materials. Otherwise, the spillage can be a problem. And it can also be used in the coal sign ore minings. And the important thing is the capacity of the belt. Capacity of the belt ranges from the 500 to 5000 meter cube per second, right? And the distance covered may be as small as 50 meters to the highest, you can see, the 5 kilometers. That means the belt from 50 meters to the 500 meters it can go, okay? Right. I am taking out the scribbled this thing. So next one is the bucket conveyor. As the name is indicated, the bucket elevator or bucket conveyor, the buckets or scoops, we can sometimes it is termed as a scoops, are used to convey the material. In order to convey the material, again the bucket is attached to any, either it is a belts or it can be in a chains. In both the way, the buckets are attached to the supporting conveyance supports, that is a belt or chain, and then it will be conveyed the material from one place to another place. Okay, the vertical, especially this vertical lift of the material, the mainly the bucket elevators are employed. So ranging from few meters to the 50 meters is a optimum height of the bucket elevator, with the highest efficiency of the conveyance can be achieved the bucket elevator, right? The capacity of the bucket elevator may be vary from 2 to 1000 tons. the capacity of the bucket, this bucket elevator, see here we are having the different components, we'll see the different components in the next slides, right? So the bucket, these are all the buckets, okay? Buckets are attached to the belt, okay? The capacity of this entire structure ranges from the 2 to 1,000 tons per hour, okay? And then I can see so there are two types of a bucket elevator. We can see the space bucket elevator and continuous bucket elevators. These are all the two types mainly. We can see the bucket elevators, the space bucket elevators, right? So what is the space bucket elevators? So this space bucket elevator, that means the elevator which is running between the two pulleys are having with the buckets with the higher spacing between the one to other. This is called the space bucket elevators, right? And again, these space bucket elevators are classified based upon its discharges. So as centrifugal discharge elevator, positive discharge elevator, marine leg elevator. That means, so this marine leg elevator is having a name. The elevator is having an inclined conveyance mechanism instead of a vertical. We have seen in the previous class, it is a vertical, the bucket elevator. In case of the marine leg, it is a slightly inclined bucket elevator. Okay, so this is called the marine leg. This is called the marine leg. Okay, so next one is the high-speed elevator. High-speed, the name itself indicates the speed of the bucket elevator is higher. That is high-speed bucket elevator, right? So, whereas the second type, the continuous bucket elevators are classified as the super capacity bucket elevator and the internal discharge bucket elevator. These are two types of bucket elevators under the continuous. This is a spaced elevator, okay? The product flow is discharged either the product flow discharged using these bucket elevators is either it is a gravity flow or it can be centrifugal forces in order to overcome the cost of the conveyance. Okay, so probably they are going for a gravity or a centrifugal conveyance. Here we can see, we have seen the centrifugal discharge type of a bucket elevator. It's a space bucket elevator. You can see the buckets or else scoops, the space will be more. Okay, so this is called the space. It's a top of the your bucket elevator where the motor is attached to the topper pulley. And here you can see the mechanism, the buckets. You can see the space, and when they come to any discharge point, they are overlagging one each other. That means the speed at this, the buckets which are all imposed is subjected for a centrifugal force. Therefore, as a result of the centrifugation, the material will be thrown out like this. So the thing is that if you hold the rope which is attached with the weight at the end of the rope, if you rotate that rope, you can see if you rotate and if you leave, the rope which is falling with the centrifugal force will be having a highest angle of inclination. This is the centrifugal discharge, we can say the falling material, falling pattern. So here there will be an outlet chute, okay, and then they will go along with the line. Okay, the next one is the positive discharge pattern. The material in case of a positive, you can see so same setup here, everything is same, whereas the discharge mechanism is a different. In case of a centrifugal, it is flowing like this, the outward throw of the grains, we can see in case of centrifugal flow pattern. Whereas in case of the positive discharge, this belt or chain which is attached, which is plugged with the scoops or buckets, or you can see even the position of the buckets, the position of the buckets is a slightly different. They are not inclined as previous one. They are slightly erected in nature. And as a result, what happens when there is an the snub idler? The snub idler is nothing but the snub idler sprocket, which is a type of the idler which is attached to take back the belt to any towards the upward direction belt, so that the whatever the material which is handling by these buckets will be arranged to fall along with the line of the flow, along with the line of, this is the along with the line of the flow. So this is the line of the flow of the bucket elevator, as well the material also flowing along the line of the flow. This is the type of a positive discharge mechanism in which we can discharge a material and it will be thrown to the outward chute, right? So mainly these are all the type of a materials. If the sticker materials are there, they will go for some centrifugal. If the very lighter materials are there, they will go for positive. So based upon the characteristics of the material, the type of the discharge mechanism will be adopted, right? Then the spaced bucket centrifugal discharge type is a most commonly. The centrifugal discharge is a most commonly used for the elevating the grains, right? So as we have seen in the previous, the either it is a gravity or a centrifugal, with respect to the speed, the low speed gravitation or a high speed. If it is a high speed, the centrifugal flows. If the low speed, then it is a gravitational discharge, it follows, right? So here we can see this is a low speed, it follows low speed gravitational discharge. So it is like a positive discharge pattern we can, but not exactly the positive, because positive will be like this. Okay, the belt will be bended towards the upward direction of the belt conveyor, bucket conveyor, and then here it is a low speed, whereas the high speed belt conveyor, you can see the centrifugal throw away. Okay. The bucket elevator's capacity may be calculated by, mainly this bucket elevator's capacity is calculated, it's a tonnes per hour, in two ways we can, the capacity of the buckets and the number of buckets per meter of the belt, okay? The capacity of the bucket which have been attached to any belt, that is a belt, the per meter. Then the number of buckets per meter of the belt and the belt speed. Or else, if you can directly calculate the capacity by capacity in terms of the capacity of the belt bucket elevator, that is the capacity, okay? So, 2,000 tonnes per hour, that is the exact capacity of the bucket elevator, right? And the material density, or material density, so whatever material we are taking out, so divided by 1,000, right? Then, we'll see what is that. Just 1 minute. Okay, highlight somewhere it has been moved out. belt conveyor. Sorry. The bucket elevator capacity is mainly depending upon the bucket size, the conveyance speed, the bucket design, the spacing, the way of loading and unloading, and the characteristics of the material. So these are all the important parameter on which the capacity of the elevator, is mainly depending on. Okay, so this is the formula which can be used to calculate the capacity of the bucket elevator, right? The main parts of the bucket elevator, so you can see the main parts, there are 5 parts are there. We'll see one by one here. The head elevator head section. See, you can see this is the elevator's head section, right? And the elevator boot section, the whatever the foot at the bottom, the idler, the bottom pulley, which is known as the elevator boot section. Okay, then elevator legs, these are all the legs. What is the buckets are also known as the legs. The belt, the belt which is attached to the bucket elevators and the buckets, right? So so here you can see the picture of the this is the leg of the your bucket elevator, and this is the boot, and this is the head, and then other other components, right? I am changing the ink of the sketch, right? So this is the mechanism. Here you can see the material is feeding to any bucket, and there is no leg over here, and the directly it is going, and it is it's like a low speed gravity flowing, and the material is falling to an outlet, and then buckets are coming back, right? The elevator belts, the total stretch of the belt under the maximum load should not exceed. It's a very important thing, you know. There is the if the stretching is more for the either it is a belt conveyor or bucket elevators, in the both the cases the strength, tensile strength of the particular belt is very important in order to overcome the slagging or slipping of the belt. If the slipping is there or slagging is there, then the conveyance efficiency is definitely is going to reduce. So therefore the maximum stretch of the belt, it should be very tight. That means it should not exceed the 1 to 2% of the belt length. Say for example we are having a 1 meter belt, right? So 1 meter belt should be stretched 1% or 2%. If the 2% means the 1.02 is the total stretch. 1.02 is the total stretch of the belt which is allowed to have an best efficient bucket elevator. Bucket elevator is a very important thing, right? So buckets. The top angle is generally taken as a 80 degrees, while the bottom angle is the 90 degrees, right? The top of the, bucket elevator, the buckets, how they are designing. Say for example, this is the bucket. The topper angle will be more. The topper angle will be more, that is a 80 degrees, in order to discharge. The more, that means the 80 degree means the more wider in order to discard the material. The bottom angle is a 20 to 30 degree. That's a lesser. That means in order to hold the material, the angle is nothing but the opening, the degree of a opening and withholding the material. That is design of the buckets they are using. See here you can see. So then what is the HP required to operate this bucket elevator? The HP is equal to QHF divided by 4562 is a constant, where Q is the capacity of the bucket elevator in terms of a kg per minute. H is a lift height, what is the height in terms of a meters, and then F is in a the factor, that is a constant, which is known as the elevator load on the upside end. Upside, if the elevator is loaded from the upside, then 1.5 is a constant and 1.2 is from the bottom side, right? There, so as per the it's a constant, F is a constant based upon the method of a feeding, either upside or bottom side. You can see, say this is the leg, the elevator from the top, it is upside. So, similar way. Bucket elevator, here there is a the material holding to from the bottom, it is taking out. This is the bottom side, right? The theoretical horsepower should be increased 10 to 15% to provide frictional and power requirement for loading and the power transmission and drive. drive loss. So always the, so whatever the HP requirement for any sort of a machines, it has been learned in the farm machinery. Say for example, the HP required for particular this bucket elevator is 5 HP as per calculated value. You should not take the 5 HP as in a motor to lift this, operate this bucket elevator. Instead, you have to go for 10 to 15% of higher than that of the. That means, say for example, 6 HP or 5.5 HP. Is the this is the pattern we have to choose the particular motor to operate the any sort of a machine with this respect, it is a bucket elevator. Okay. Then again, applications, we just go through the various applications where it has been used. Here it is a chain attached bucket elevator. The figure you can see the granular material, lime and cements and powders, even powders we can fertilizers. A wide range of applications the bucket elevator is having other than agriculture, and then even in heated condition also it can be used, right? Then next is a screw conveyor. The name itself is indicating the screw is a conveying the materials. That is consist of a tabular or U-shape. It's a tubular or U-shape. These are two forms of the the screw conveyors. This is a screw. This is a screw. Okay. The screw. Right, through which the shaft which is spirally revolving, I mean to say this is tubular and this is a U shape, right? Here you can see the feed is fed from one end and which is having in a common axis. The motor is operated on the bearing. Through the bearings it is the motion is transferred, and then the screw conveyor is having the flights various degrees of the inclinations depending, again it is a depending upon the characteristics of the stickiness of the materials. Okay, and then due to that inclination the material will be moved forward, right? So it's an Archimedes screw where the material can also be not only in horizontal axis, it can be also inclined axis. The material can be handled. The screw conveyor is generally used to move grains horizontally, and however it can also be used angles up to the 90 degrees. Even it can be horizontal to the 90 degrees of angles, the material conveyance can be done using the screw conveyor from the horizontal, but the capacity reduces. See, if the capacity of the horizontal conveyance using the screw conveyor is, say for example, 10 tons per hour, if it keeps increasing its angle of inclination, say when it goes to any 90 degrees, definitely there will be an additional dead weight comes along with the grains, as well as the operational HP which is needed to convey the material. So at the end of the conveyance, the capacity of the particular the screw conveyor is reducing, as well the power required to convey that particular material is also be increasing. Okay, the pitch of the standard screw, which is you can see, so this is the first one is the diameter of the screw, and then the second one is the pitch of the screw for the screw flight. This is known as the flight, the center of the flight of the one screw to the center of the flight of the subsequent to the same pitch is known as the pitch. And then this is the length of the screw, right? The capacity of the screw conveyor is given as the 47.2 into D2 minus small d2 into PN, where the D is the diameter, screw diameter, small d is the shaft diameter, P is the pitch, and N is the RPM of the screw conveyor. Then the power requirement, HP, is the QLWF divided by 4560. So where Q is the capacity of the conveyor, W is the bulk density, F is the material factor. So various materials are having the various, the conveyance factors as a constant. Here you can see the material is fed from this inlet tube, where the material is transferred in an inclined manner. Say for example, this is in a 45 degrees. Just to for an instant, I am telling, the material is moved from one point to other point with respect to two point. That is a motion of the screw, which is a forward direction. That's as well the inclination of the screws. Inclination of the screws are towards the motion, right? So here the different components, it's a U trough. We have seen there are mainly two types. One is a tubular and it's a U type. Okay, this is a U type, the screw conveyor. So A is a screw conveyor, B is a component, that's a C is a hanger bearings, and then trough ends, the trough covers, flanges, discharge ports, supporting, etc. So these are all the various components we can see in case of a screw conveyor, right? So what is the applications? So applications, the handling of a great variety of a bulk materials, even from the very sticky material to free flowing materials, we can handle in this type. That's a very biggest advantage using the screw conveyor. Okay. So use a mix of various together break last type of a and smaller type of lumps can also be used to transfer. And even this the specific application of this screw conveyor, even in cooler, heater and dry natures, this material screw conveyor can be used to transit the material. Okay, that's the biggest advantage of any of the two types which we have seen in the previous type. Even the vapor type, it can be also used to convey the toxic and hazardous products by tightly closing them. Either it is a, if it is a U type, the cover will be closed. If it is a U type, the cover will be closed tightly with respect to the vapor type. Then the conveyor which conveys the toxic or hazardous products safely to any disposal points, right? Then the next one is a pneumatic conveyor. The conveyor which moves the granular material is very important. This is a pneumatic conveyor mainly used for granular material handling in closed duct, because the closed duct is the point where the pneumatic, that is a negative pressure, can be created by high velocity of the air stream. The high velocity of the air stream, here it is the terminal velocity of the granular material is the point. Okay, if the terminal material of the pad is, say for example, 4 meters per second, so if it is a 4.1, then the material can be easily lifted out and it can be discharged. So that is the high velocity meaning, and the granular materials which can be transported, right? The pneumatic conveying system shall be a source of blowing, air blowing or a suction. As I told, it can be either a pneumatic or it can be pressurized. Either it can blow air or you can suck the air. Again, both the way material can be handled by means of feeding the product into the conveyors, right? And then the feed dispersion of the bulk material and air velocity, the major, the important component over here, it is the important point is that pneumatic conveyors can be economical to operate at the 15 to 30 meters per second. Okay, and then the applications can be utilized for many dry bulk materials. Okay, so it's a very important thing. Here you can see this is a negative pressure, negative or a vacuum. It is not a blowing type of a pneumatic conveyor. See here, the silo is filled up with a material, that is a granular material. And here you can see the what is known as negative pressure creator. So where from the negative pressure, the is a, it should not be more than that of the terminal velocity of the material, and the material will be transported in this manner in case of the pneumatic conveyor. Then next is a chain conveyor. Chain conveyor consists of a two elements, the chain element and chain attachment. Okay, so this is a chain. So as such, chain is not conveying any sort of a material. Okay, any sort of a material. Okay, so therefore chain, again it is attached with some sort of a things. That means that is a conveying object, conveying parameters, right? So these two are important elements in case of a chain conveyor. So chain elements are made up of, elements are made up of, chain is made up of cast iron, exclusively used for packages. This chain conveyor is exclusively used for package transports, right? And then a chain is a reliable machine compound which transmit power by means of a tensile forces and is used primarily for power transmission conveyance systems, right? So that is the definition of the chain conveyor. The types of a chain conveyors, you can see based upon the material made. It is a cast iron chain, cast steel chain. So it is again depending upon the type of material we are. If it is a food material to be handled, then the steel type of a chain they are using. Then the mining ores, and they are using the iron chains and forged chains, steel chains, etc. Right, plastic chains. So again, the chain conveyors based upon the conveyance, it has been classified three types: scrapper type chain conveyor, apron chain conveyor, bucket chain conveyor, right? So what is the scrapper chain conveyor? Two endless chains passes through trough. The chains are attached to wooden plate, which is called as a flight. That is the material handling element. The package to be transported is kept on the flight, and chain pulls this container, right? So here you can see, so this is the chain, this is the chain, right? So this chain consists of these flights. So these flights will be carried out the packaging materials, right? So this is about the scrapper chain. And then the apron type chain. There are two endless chains accompanied with the rollers. These chains are connected through a steel pan exclusively used for transport of a heavy loads. Transport of a heavy loads. In previous case, it's a packaging material, maybe it's lighter loads, whereas here it is a heavy loads because we are using the rollers, right? The speed ranges between the 70 to 100 feet per minute, right? So here you can see the two endless chains, and then these chains are connected through a steel pan. So this is the steel pans, right? And these particular apron type, if you look at these things, that it looks like an aprons, right? And the last one is a bucket chain. As I told earlier, the bucket elevators can also be termed, classified in the chain conveyors as the bucket is attached to the chain, right? The bucket is made up of cast iron, plastic or steel. So depending upon the type of application we are using for material handling, bucket may be flatter for carrying the sticky material, flatter. Say for example, this is the bucket, so this is a flatter, okay? Sticky material, steel buckets are using the larger particles, right? The distance between the two buckets should be maintained, as well as the distance between the bottom of the boot to the boot of the bucket should be maintained to avoid the sticking between the each other of the buckets. Okay, so this is the buckets, the flatter buckets you can see, and then the distance between the buckets is very less. Right. So next, application of the chain conveyors, where the transport of heavy loads and packaging materials, and even in high temperature zones like in ovens. So the conveyance can be possible using the chain conveyors, and then it can be continuous or it can be indexing modes or in break up mode. The conveyance can be continuous or a break up mode, right? Unlike other type, then chain conveyors very simple and exceptional durability. Because these chains do not have any sort of a, like in a earlier cases we have seen the turning out, or it can be a wear and tear problems are very less in case of a chains. So roller conveyors, next one, the last one is a roller conveyors. The pathway consists of a series of a loads that are perpendicular to the direction of a travel. See here, the rollers which has been attached to any frames, that's a fixed frame, these are all the rollers which have been embedded to the this frame, are in movable position, whereas these the frames are fixed positions. Okay, the series of a rollers that are perpendicular direction of the travel. So perpendicular, the direction of the travel which are all perpendicular. The load must possess a flat bottom to span several rollers. The load, whatever load we are loading, it should be having a flat bottom. The power roller rotates to drive the loads forward, upward. Also available, the rollers use the parallel rollers mounted on frames to convey the product either by gravity or a manual. So here the most of the roller type conveyors are this type, gravity or a manual. That means there won't be any power operation to drive these rollers. Say for example, this is a roller, right? So attached to any the frames. So they won't used to have any driving mechanism. Other words, they will be used to move based upon the gravity or a manual movement, right? So there is also the provision to attach, integrate with the drive, that is a motors. That is a very lesser application it is having. The key specification includes in the roller is a diameter and the axle center diameters. These two are the very important, roller diameter and the axle center dimensions, right? So the key to be designed or a to enhance the capacity. In either cases, the basic roller conveyor structure consists of a side rails. So whatever we have seen, these are all the side rails, and punching, the rollers will rolls will be punched out, and the spaced holes along with their length, right? This is the applications of the roller. You can see this is a type of a roller. So in any angles, any direction, any sort of a bendings, we can use for rollers. So specifically used for primarily handling applications such as a load docks, bagging, handling and assembling lines. So these are important applications where it can be rolled out. See the example, you can see it's a roller type of a conveyors where it conveys. So the bottles from with the inclination the duly having in a the driver mode type of a things. Dear students, with this I am going to wind off today's class, that is the material handling equipments. In that we have studied various type, that is six type of a material handling equipment. So one is a belt, bucket, screw conveyor, chain pneumatic conveyor, chain conveyor, and the roller conveyor. So these are all the six type of a conveyors we have seen. So each and every conveyors have their own applications and advantages when it comes to any usages, right? So with this I will wind up with asking the questions and answers. We just go through the
different types of questions along with the answers I have given, and some of the important questions just been mentioned. Dear students, your doubts in this consent may kindly be asked, and don't forget to drop your feedback in terms of a yes or no, right? So I have given the 6 questions. You just go through the 6 question. The thing you have to do is you drop any comment with respect to yes or yes. If it is a yes, you write a Y. If it is a no, you write yeah. Only these 2 type of answers for questions, you write question number 1, yes or no. Question number 2, yes or no. Okay, got the point? So please kindly drop your feedback with respect to the today's lecture. The question number 1, yes or no. Okay, this type of a feedback I am looking forward, and you please go through the material very carefully. If it is not understood, please ask me, right? Thank you.